morning. It's great to be with you again this morning. You know, over the centuries of history, there have been probably hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of songs that have been written. We are privileged to live in an era where Christian music is just something that we just have a smorgasbord of. This morning, I want to share concerning a song from heaven. Comes out of Luke 2:14, it says, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men and women on whom his favour dwells." As they had done regularly before, the shepherds in our account of Christmas were out at night looking after the sheep. They were then interrupted and witnessed a phenomena and a spectacle which I would assume would have been difficult to describe. Heaven had sent an angel accompanied by its music group to declare the coming of Christ as the Saviour of the world. And today we will look at this simple yet profound song from heaven and how it affects us in our lives. So I'm doing something different today in the fact that I'm going to have three mini sermons. It's a little bit like having a snack and then another snack. And then another snack. You know how you just eat on the run? Hopefully it adds up to a meal. But in between each one, we're going to pause for a moment to just be led in a song that will just reinforce in our heart and give us the opportunity to respond to the truth that we've just heard. This little song starts, "Glory to God in the highest." It declares that bringing glory and exaltation to God and placing him on the highest place is a foundational principle in the kingdom of God. It is not just a way of introducing people. It is not just something that you put at the start to make it sound good. This is a foundational principle and truth. It is foundational in heaven for the angels. Revelation 4:8 tells us this, "Day and night they never stop saying, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord, God Almighty, who was, who is, and who is to come.'" It's foundational for creation. Revelation 5:13 tells us, "And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them singing to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb, be praise and honour and glory and power forever and ever." It's foundational for our lives if we follow him. John 4:23 tells us, "For the time is coming and now has come when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks." In other words, he's looking out for them. If we just wind back in time a little bit to the Old Testament, into Exodus chapter 20, where it tells us about the Ten Commandments. It begins this way and says, "I am the Lord your God. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make an idol to bow down and worship. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God." Worship and the preeminence of God is foundational to every conversation, every act, every experience that happens in the kingdom of God. And then Paul in Romans tells us what we have done often as humans. Romans chapter 1 verses 21 and 20 to 23 says, "For although they knew God," Paul writes, "they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him. But their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. And although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and they exchanged," listen to this, "they exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like birds and animals and reptiles." The battle in our own lives today, the battle in our society, is not predominantly about morality or behavior, but one of allegiance. The first major issue of life that we need to ask is, what place do we give to the Creator? Is it the highest place, the foremost place, the most important in bringing Him honor and worship? Otherwise, we have sidelined or relegated Him out of the center of our lives. One day Jesus was asked what was the greatest commandment, to which He replied, "Hear, O Israel." If He was standing here this morning, He'd say, "Hey, I want you to listen, all the people of Hervey Bay. The Lord our God, the Lord is one. You should love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength." We're reminded through Ray's message last Sunday that when the Magi found the young boy Jesus, what was the very first thing they did? They worshipped Him, because it was the foundational principle of the kingdom of God. When John the Baptist was preparing the way and getting people ready for Christ's ministry, he said these words in John 3 and verse 20, "He must increase and I must decrease." That is worship. It has been said that the simple definition of worship is simply this: He goes up and I go down. We sometimes, and particularly around this time of year, we use the little phrase, "I really want to be able to celebrate Christmas." I would put the challenge to my heart first before I even share it to you today. We cannot celebrate Christmas unless He is in the highest place of our heart. That's why the angel started this song in this particular way. Matt's going to lead us in a very simple chorus. You may know it. If you do, I'd love you just to stay seated though and sing along. You'll sing it through a couple of times. If you don't know it, you'll pick it up. "We place you on the highest place, for you are the great high priest. You are our mediator. We place you far above all else, and we come to you and worship at your feet." Thank you, Matt.
We place you on the highest place, for you are the great high priest. We place you high above all else, and we come to you and worship at your feet. We place you on the highest place. The great high priest, we place you high above all else, and we come to you and worship at your
So the angels came that night and they sang glory to God in the highest. And it had deep meaning for the history of the world. And then they went on to say, and on earth, peace. It would appear at first glance that the choir from heaven got this one horribly wrong. I just looked up this last week some simple stats from the internet. For the 20 years since 2003 to this time, there have been over 120 hostile conflicts and wars around the globe with millions and millions of people who have been killed in the last 20 years. Of those, there are right at this time still between 45 and 50 of those major conflicts happening around the world today as we sit here. In fact, since the end of World War II, there are more current wars and conflicts happening right this day than any individual of the 77 years since 1945. Far from becoming more peaceful, our world is sliding the wrong way very quickly. And I think most of us recognize that it is the same trend in society with individuals and families. And yet it seems, despite this, we still take the path of moving away from our Maker and Creator rather than seeking Him with all of our heart. So what is this promise? That first Christmas, God had a gift for the world, and the gift was His Son, Jesus. From His life and message, we learned that if we honored Him first, loved Him and followed Him, He would dwell with us, and He would dwell in us. This is the God mystery that John wrote about in John 1 and 12 and 13. To all who received Him, to those who believed on His name, He gave the right or the privilege to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or of a husband's will, but born of God. This speaks about those who accept the gift of heaven, who is Jesus, into our lives. If we go back to Isaiah, written 700 years before Jesus came, it in chapter 9 and verse 6, the prophet wrote these words in the foretelling of this one who would come and called Him the Prince of Peace. Christ is the true source of authentic peace. And then in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 14, we read these words, for He Himself is our peace. The peace being sung about that night was not a national or an international or a family peace, but an indwelling peace in the human heart, part of receiving the gift of heaven, Jesus. Peace is in fact a person. Peace is a person. As a matter of fact, Jesus never spoke of a global peace until His final return. In the meantime, He says it will be the opposite. Talking with His disciples, as recorded in John chapter 16 and verse 33, He said, I have told you these things so that in Me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. The peace that Jesus brings is a gift, not an experience determined by a circumstance. Usually when we use this word in our vocabulary, it's the absence of conflict. It's the fact that some stress has been taken away, and we're describing an experience that we are then enjoying. But the peace that Jesus speaks about is the peace that comes from His very character, that is the gift into our lives to be able to know for certainty and have a confidence in all situations, regardless of where we find ourselves in. When the Apostle Peter was thrown into prison in the book of Acts, not knowing whether the next day he would still have his life, it's recorded that he was in a deep sleep between the guards. Rather than stressed, it seems that his heart was at peace even when his life was under threat. Some years ago in this church, a fine Christian professional man was falsely accused by authorities in our state of a major crime. It took 2 years to clear his name, and the judge finally said that it should never have gone to court in the first place. But during that 2 years, this man displayed a deep trust in Christ, was continually joyful, and told those around him not to worry. He knew the Prince of Peace. And again, the words of Jesus in John 14, 27, he says, "Peace I leave with you. It's a gift I'm giving to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Don't let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." Peace came to us as a person. The name of God coming to us is called Emmanuel. God is with us. Matt's going to lead us just in that song as we reflect on God's gift to us today, the person of Jesus, the peace that the angels sung about that night, that you and I can have right this day, regardless of what the news brings up tonight, what the media records. You have Christ. Thanks, Matt. Let's stay remained seated. Let's sing it together.
Oh, come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of day spring come and cheer our eyes by thy advent here. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night and death's dark shadows put to
the song that night was very short. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to all men and women on whom his favor dwells. God does not select out favorites. Some translations say all men who please him, or all men in whom he is well pleased. But this may tempt us to believe that we need to strive to win his favor, which is not the case. Favor, I believe, here refers to his grace. When His grace comes into our lives, His favour is upon our lives. So the promise of the angels that night was a special gift of peace to all people, regardless of age, race, background, social strata, intellectual or other ability, who in welcoming Christ into their lives and saying, "Thank you for this extraordinary gift," receive His grace that provided forgiveness of sin, release from shame, and freedom from bondage and addictions. A time when I have witnessed this peace in lives is being with people in the days and even hours before they die. I have many beautiful and amazing memories of those who have received Christ, often showing a peace that is indescribable as they wait to go home. But I have also seen the anxious soul. One lady comes to mind. She had regularly attended church, but I never realized until I sat beside her hospital bed, which turned out only a matter of 2 days before she passed away, that she never really knew Jesus and had not received His gift to her. And at the time as we talked, she was gripped by fear of the unknown that lay ahead. And I shared with her the story of Jesus and prayed with her. But friends, today, the good news through the angels that night was not one of religion. It was not a format. It was not a set of rules. It was not an institution or a ritual or a tradition. It was not a set of meaningless sacrifices. It was a person. And His name is Jesus. He came and He pitched His tent next to ours, as recorded in John 1. And He gave His life at Calvary for our sin. And in doing so, He brought the gift of peace of heaven into our lives. We do not have to strive today to win His favor. It's bestowed upon us as a gift through His grace. Long before Jesus came, and in all the years since, people have pursued and today continue to pursue avenues of wanting to appease God. Sadly, it lacks joy. It does not offer hope for the future and can often just add to the despair of their lives. I share with you this morning the song of heaven, simple and brief. Brought a reassurance of a God of compassion who loved us, who knows us by name, who understands our challenges and recognizes our weaknesses, and He provides an eternal hope for the future. So this morning, whenever we meet Him, walk with Him, experience Him, encounter Him, we realize the foundational principle is we should worship Him with our heart. He goes up, we go down. We place Him on the highest place in our lives and give Him glory 24/7. But today, our responsibility is to be able to receive the gift. Many gifts are going to be given in this next week to one another, and wouldn't it be a tragedy for those who left them open and didn't share the joy? What a tragedy today for those that have not unpacked the gift of heaven and received Christ into their lives. If you're one of those people today, I just encourage you, by faith, in these last moments of the service, just reach out to Him. He's waiting to hear the intent of your heart. And as the Prince of Peace, He allows us the experience of not being snowed under the pressures of this world, but walking through life's challenges in partnership with him. Friend, this is amazing grace. Matt's going to lead us in this as we sing this morning. I'd love for you to just set your hearts free. This is not a song in church. As we are in the presence of the King, we don't have the choir of heaven this morning, but we have their song. Thank you, Matt, as you lead us. Let's stay seated, and during it, Matt might invite us to stand.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but
Father, we humbly come before you as the huge beneficiaries of your gift. And today, Father, may we just continue on this pathway of learning to worship, just learning to respond, and living in the reality of the peace of your Son. In Jesus' name, amen.